Hi, it's Jessica Rector, host and founder of This Man Thing, where we help men become their truest, best, badass selves. So glad that you're here with us today, and I'm super excited about the interview that we're doing. So you can find us at thismanthing.com. You can also join our free Facebook group at thismanthing.com/groups, where men are getting much needed community and support and advice from other men who are just like them. Sometimes you feel stuck or alone in whatever you're going through, and these men are here to connect with you and give you some no BS feedback so you can move forward and make massive progress. Please help me welcome my guest today, Dr. Robert Glover, who's the author of No More Mr. Nice Guy, a proven plan for getting what you want in love, sex, and life. Dr. Glover is an internationally recognized authority on the nice guy syndrome. He's a frequent guest on radio talk shows and has been featured in numerous national publications through his book, online classes, workshops, podcasts, blogs, consultations, and therapy groups. Dr. Glover has helped change the lives of countless men and women around the world. Dr. Glover lives in Puerto Vallarta, Mexico. Please help me give a warm welcome to Dr. Glover.
Thank you, Jessica. It's good to be here.
Thank you so much.
You've already made my day with just that right there. I can call it a good day now.
Yay! Hey, that's how every day should be, right?
You betcha.
Yay! Well, thank you so much for being here. So start us off and tell us a little bit how you got started down the path of discovering what the nice guy syndrome is, and really, what is the nice guy syndrome?
Okay, well, the nice guy syndrome, basically, when I wrote No More Mr. Nice Guy, I tell people that it's my autobiography. If you'd looked up nice guy in the dictionary, you would have seen my picture there. And I was that guy that was trying to make everybody happy, wanted everybody to like me, everybody to approve of me, nobody ever to think negative of me or get angry at me or confront me. And so, you know, I was just trying to do everything right, make everybody happy, avoid conflict, did a lot of giving to get, wanted to be appreciated. And during my second marriage, that started backfiring on me. Mm-hmm. And my wife didn't appreciate me all the time and was critical and would accuse me of being passive aggressive. And she finally said, "You need to go get some therapy." She said, "I'd rather live with an asshole. At least an asshole, you know what you're going to get. With you, I never know. Because one moment you're happy and everything's good. And next moment, you're passive aggressive or you're having a victim puke and you're blowing up on me." She said, "You need to go get some help." So I did. And I went to go get some help to find out why me being a nice guy didn't make her a better wife or make her appreciate me more. And I started learning about boundaries. I started learning about making my needs a priority. I started learning about really how to communicate and talk about what was important and real rather than just pressing it down and avoiding the conflict. And during that time, my training's in marriage and family therapy, and a lot of the couples coming to see me, the guys were saying the exact same things I was. "I'm a nice guy. I do everything right. I'm better than her ex. I treat her well. I'm raising her kids, but it's never enough. She's never happy. She never wants to have sex. She's always angry. When's it going to be my turn?" And I thought I could finish their sentences for them.
Wow.
So, short story, we started a nice guy group. I started writing some lessons for them. They all said, "You should write a book. You should go on Oprah." I wrote the book, never made it on Oprah, but here we are talking about nice guys.
But what's interesting is as you're saying that, you actually gave me goosebumps, because I think a lot of times when men are boys, they're told that they need to be nice, that they need to be accommodating, that they, and so they become that, right? And then somehow it doesn't serve them when they become a man. So what do we need to change in order for there to not be a disconnect in that?
Well, that's a really big question. And we could talk a long time about that, because a lot of what happens for a lot of guys, I mean, a lot of nice guys I work with, just they're born maybe with an easygoing temperament. It's their nature. Mm-hmm. And that's fine. That's great. A lot of them grow up with messages, either subtly or not so subtle. Be different from your father. Mm. Don't be like your drunk father, your father that abandoned the family. Don't be like all the other bad men that only use women and want sex. And a lot of them grow up with single moms or moms that are either dominant in the family or depressed, and, mm-hmm. and so the boy's either trying to make mom happy one way or another. And really where it really starts blowing up on the average guy is when he hits adolescence and wants the attention of the opposite sex. And he thinks, well, I'll be a good guy. I won't be like the jerks I've heard women complain about. I'll listen to her talk about her problems. I'll help her. I'll be nice to her. And as you know, that just ends the guys up in the friend zone. Mm-hmm. And these guys then come away thinking, well, women just aren't interested in me. They're not attracted to me. They only want the jerks. And that leads to a lot of ongoing frustration and with nice guys of thinking, well, I'm just not good enough. I'm not desirable. A lot turned to pornography. Mm-hmm. A lot just quit trying. And then that follows them throughout their adult life. So to answer your question is in a short version, probably to help reverse this, we need more men involved with little boys, especially their sons, giving them a positive, powerful male masculine influence, and especially helping them initiate them into the scary, difficult, dangerous world of the adult masculine, which often, as I said, begins when they start being interested in girls or the opposite sex, however they define that.
Yeah. And you know what? So when I was younger, I thought, oh, well, yeah, I'd like a guy who's nice and who treats me well. But I will tell you right now, as an adult, the most attractive thing in a man to me is confidence. Mm-hmm. Like, confidence is sexy. It's hot. That's what I want. Men who are nice, what I call it, yes men. Yes, yeah. Man. Like, I don't want a yes man, and I don't think any woman wants a yes man, even if she, like, wants her own way, or I don't think that any woman wants a yes man, because what that says is he can't stick up for himself. He doesn't own his power. He gives his power away. He doesn't really know who he is or what he wants, or if he does, he doesn't know how to verbalize it. Every woman wants a guy who's going to, even if she doesn't outwardly admit it, every woman wants a guy who can stand up to her, who can give her a different opinion, who can challenge her, not in an aggressive, egotistical way, but can challenge her and call her out on stuff, because that is how we grow as humans. If we have a yes partner, we're never going to grow. We're going to stay in this bubble. And I think the disconnect happens is that men don't realize that that's actually what women want, that we want a fully confident man who can embrace his power and embrace his confidence.
Yeah. Well, here's the deal. You know this. There's a lot of strong women out there. And you've grown up in a culture that encourages that, and that's great. But you've also, as women, learned, well, I'm not sure I can always count on a man or depend on him to follow through or be there or keep his word. And so you've learned to take charge. You've learned to take control. Well, all of us nice guys out there think you gals want that. You want to be in control. You want to be in charge. So we go, well, okay, I'll be nice. I'll accommodate you. I'll let you do what you want, and I'll try to, you know, facilitate that. And my training's in marriage and family therapy. I've listened to countless women. I'm now on my third marriage, so I've been with a few women. And for example, my wife is Mexican. She was a single mom before I met her. She grew up in poverty. She's strong. She's tough. She's intelligent. I tell people she's stronger, fiercer, and more intelligent than I am. But she also regularly tells me, she says, I've got big balls, but I don't want my balls to be bigger than my man. I don't want to say jump and my man says how high. And she tells me, I love it when you tell me no. I love it when you're firm. I love it when you have direction. And I've heard those kind of messages from countless strong women. Mm-hmm. They can be the strongest person in the room, but they don't want to be. It doesn't turn them on. It doesn't give them a sense of security or well-being or trust to where they can just open up and trust the man. And that's when things start to get interesting for women, is when they can let go, open up, trust, and then the man starts taking them places they can't take themselves. And that's emotionally, it's physically, sexually, energetically. And I tell the single guys I work with, when you approach a woman with confidence, and it doesn't even matter if you feel confidence, just getting up the nerve to walk across the room,
yes,
and introduce yourself. I say, when you approach a woman with confidence, she experiences the exact same brain chemicals that you as a guy experience if she would lift up her shirt and show you her tits. It's biological. Wow. It's Mother Nature's wired into us, and you've already attested. Yeah. You want a guy with confidence, not just because you've been taught that. You know it as a woman. That confidence is strength. It's fierceness when necessary. He can set the tone. He can take the lead, and he can do it with love, and he can do it with consciousness and compassion. And that those things are all a turn-on for women, at least the ones that keep talking to me.
And what's interesting, so this is very timely for me. I am a strong woman, and I have always, for whatever reason, I want a strong man, but for whatever reason, that's not the guy that my dating history has shown that I've gone out with. And I went out with a strong man. And here's what happened in a strong woman who's not used to dating a strong man. It had me second guess or questioning, like, can two strong people be together and it work? Because here's what's happened. When you're a single mom and you've had to be the strong one for so long, what do you have to give up or what do you have to relax? And you're exactly right. It's not that I want to be the strong one. I've had to be the strong one, right?
Right.
And so what is it that women need to give up or relax on in order to be with a strong man? Because here's the thing, there are going to be men listening saying, okay, but if I become a strong man or if I'm a strong man, how does it work with me wanting to be with a strong woman? Because I don't believe anybody wants to be with a weak partner. I think everybody wants to be with a strong partner, but they don't know how it's going to work because they may think you're going to be butting heads if you're with a strong partner. So how does that look and what adjustments need to be made?
Okay, well, that's basically the subject of the book I'm working on right now, is how men can show up in a conscious way and set the tone and take the lead, and how women can learn to trust in a strong partner, let go, and enjoy that ride, okay? So let me give you an illustration, and this often seems to help. A lot of times when men and women meet, if you got this strong woman, and by the way, I've got like about 200 podcasts on my website I've recorded, and forever the most number one most downloaded for nice guys is how to deal with strong and controlling women. So, yeah. So apparently there's this thing going on out there that you're talking about. So here's the deal, and I have empathy for you women, because historically, your only choices have been the asshole jerk that treats you like shit, you can't trust him, he's not faithful, you know, he steals your money, sleeps around on you, doesn't call back, that, or the passive wimp that says, yes, whatever you want, I'll do that for you, but you can't trust him, you can't depend on him. There's not that healthy man with passion, with consciousness, with intention. He knows where he's going. And one of the things I tell women, okay, decide where it is you want to go. Now, you've been trying to get there on your own as a single mom, and if you want a relationship, look around and find a man that's going in the kind of direction you want to go, and then go see if there's a way to connect with that person. Mm. Don't just wait to get lucky for you know, the right guy to come along. You need to be more conscious about that.
But yes.
Here's what I tell guys, really, to answer your question. Say a man and a woman meet. I'll use the analogy of driving a car, okay? If a man and a woman meet up, hook up, get connected early on, and if the woman's used to being in charge, and if the guy's used to letting women be in charge and thinking, well, that's what they want. I'll be nice. I'll let her have her way. And the guy actually thinks, I'm being a good person. I'm giving her what she wants, control. And so let's say the woman gets in the driver's seat of the car, the nice guy gets in the passenger seat, and she just takes off driving. And he thinks, well, she wants to drive. She wants to be in control. So he just kind of sits over there and tries to accommodate, or looks out the window, or, you know, tolerates Katy Perry on the radio and doesn't say he can't stand Katy Perry, you know. And he thinks, because she wants to be in control. Nothing ever changes. She thinks, well, he's not going to drive, so I guess I have to. Mm-hmm. And he's thinking, I guess she wants to drive. I don't want to piss her off and say, wait, let me drive. But switch that around. I found that when the man with consciousness and presence, not trying to control anybody, not trying to dominate anybody, he says, hey, come on, let's go. Opens a woman's door, puts her in the passenger seat, climbs in, starts driving. He says, hey, let's go do this. And she can say yes or no, but he's got a plan. They take off driving. And let's use an example. They're on a trip. Mm-hmm. And he takes off driving. And after a little bit, she says, you know, you've been driving for a while. You might be tired. Would you like me to drive for a while? And he can say, sure. I'll pull over to the next stop. We'll switch. You get in. I'll rest for a little bit. She drives for a little bit, but she knows she only has to drive for a little while. And he'll say, okay, I'm rested. Let's switch. That's reciprocity, where there's a trading back and forth. And I found that when the man, if he's the most inherently masculine person in the relationship, says, come on, let's go. And if the woman, if she's the most inherently feminine person in the relationship, says, sure, I'd like to go with you there. And she knows she can trust him. He'll lead. When necessary, she can climb on top and enjoy the ride, or knowing that he'll take back over. And there's a reciprocity. But when that woman starts driving the bus, driving the car from the very beginning, and the man's passive from the very beginning, she just assumes she's going to have to stay in control. He just assumes she wants to be, and it never changes. There's no back and forth, no reciprocity. So I tell men, this is not about controlling anybody. It's not about being a dominant asshole or getting your way. It's about showing up with a plan and opening the woman's door, saying, come on, let's go. And every woman I've had in my life over the last several years, girlfriends, my wife, we've been married 6 months now, my mother, my granddaughter, I'm surrounded by bright, intelligent, strong women. Mm-hmm. And I don't need to dominate them. I don't need to tell them what to do. But they like it when I show up with a plan, and they like it when I open their door and hold their door and put them in the car first and say, okay, let's go. So just think in terms of setting the tone and leading based on what interests you, what's important to you, and inviting a great woman to come be a part of that. And if you have no great life or no interesting direction you're going, what are you going to invite a woman into? Right. So that's where I often tell men, let's start. Let's start with your great life. And then you've got something to say to a woman, hey, come on, let's go. Let's just go enjoy the ride.
I think what you say is key. I think there is a lot of confusion with men or uncertainty with men. They think that if a woman's strong, that she wants to lead and they'll just go along for the ride. And that is not the case at all. It's that we've had to lead. We've had to be strong. We would love for a guy to come in there and be strong and be decisive and not sit there and be wishy-washy, but mm-hmm. to make a decision. I mean, as easy as where are we going for dinner? Well, where do you want to go? Well, what kind of blah, blah, blah? No, I mean, what do you like? I like seafood. Okay, let's go here. Awesome. Great. Let's go. As opposed to spending 30 minutes deciding where you're going to go eat. That is a turn on. That is awesome. When a guy can come in there and say, hey, boom, let's do this. Okay, we're not sitting there going back and forth about a very minor decision. But women are also not used to that. Yep. We're used to men accommodating. And mm-hmm. accommodating gets old. It gets old because it takes so much time and energy. Oh, where do you want to go eat? Or I don't know. Well, what sounds good? And you know, it goes back and forth, back and forth. And when a guy comes in there and makes the decision, it's almost a surprise because it happened to me recently. I was like, oh my gosh, a decisive man. I love it. I love it.
I love your expression, because this is what I'm teaching men. And a lot of times when they hear it from me, they go, okay, you know, no, I don't believe that's true. Women want to be in control, or women are this. But, and again, if you're having to be strong in so many areas of your life, as a mom, in the workplace, in everyday decisions, and then you got to be strong in your relationship too, it is a lot of work. And I tell guys, you know, the majority of women love it if you let them know on Monday, say, okay, I've made a reservation for us on Friday night. I'm picking you up at 7 o'clock. Wear something slinky and fun with high heels, and I'll see you at 7. And that's all the information you have. You don't know anything more than that, other than Okay, what shoes am I wearing? What outfit? Do I need to get my nails done? How am I going to accessorize it? And now you're in your total feminine of feeling filled. All I said is I'm picking you up at 7.
But that's, he was dead on because he told us exactly what we needed to know, right? The time you're picking us up, wear something slinky, or get your heels on, outfit. Like the women are just thinking, well, I need to know where we're going so I need to know, so I know what to wear. Well, you told me what I need to wear, like, and what time to be ready. Those are the only two things that we need to know. We're good. Like, we don't care. Like, we're just wanting to know what we need to wear. I mean, if a guy did that, like, that is a big deal. Like, you got me so excited just by saying that. I was like, oh my gosh, where's that guy?
I'm ready. You know, Friday night's coming. I want that. And can you imagine a relationship with a guy that had enough consciousness and enough presence to show up consistently like that? And for the last, I'd say over the last 8 to 10 years, the had four maybe significant relationships during that time. And as I said, I'm now married, one of those significant relationships. And with all four of those women, I told them after about the third date, I said, if we keep seeing each other, here's what you can count on me. Four things. Number one, I'll be conscious. I will pay attention to us, to you, to me. I'll be paying attention to what's going on. Number two, I will be honest with you. Everything I will tell you will be the truth. You won't ever find out later it was part of the truth, half the truth, or completely untrue. I said, I'll be transparent with you. You'll know what I'm thinking, what I'm feeling, what I want, where I'm going, what I expect of you. And number four, I will set the tone and take the lead. I'll show up with a plan. I won't ask you, what do you want to do tonight? Do you want to do something? And I have no desire to be in control, but I'll say, hey, how about we go do this Friday night? And you can say, well, I was kind of thinking about this. And we'll have a little conversation and we'll work it out. But at least I'll show up with a plan and I'll be paying attention. And I tell men, start by always opening a woman's door for her. And a woman taught me that. And I'll tell them, it's a way of being consistent and do it all the time. Don't just do it part of the time. Always open the woman's door, getting in your car, go around, let her out of the car when you come to a building, and tell the woman, I will always open the door. It's a minor thing. Women can open their own door, but I've consistently done that, and women consistently tell me how good it feels. It feels feminine, and they've also told me every now and then if I forget, like if I, you know, forget to come around and open their car door, they'll go, no, wait a minute. You've trained me to be this way. Don't you go and change the rules now. I'm trusting you. I expect you to follow through. And I found that even just doing that little thing consistently teaches women, I can count on this guy. I can depend on him. I can trust him. I can let go of control. I can just be me and enjoy being feminine and go along for that ride. And when I need to, I can step back up into the driver's seat, but I don't have to all the time. And it lets you open up. And I don't know how much time we have, but that's the beginning part of you starting getting to feel the deep feminine bliss of being deeply penetrated by a man, not just physically, but emotionally, energetically, sexually. It's about the man bringing all of his presence and you going, I'm ready. Bring it all to me. And you being able to completely let go and trust. And I tell men, for women, trust equals lust. And if you don't trust a guy, you're not going to open yourself up to him. And if you trust him, you'll open up completely and let him take you wherever he's going, and you can let go and enjoy the ride. And that's something that most women never experienced. And it takes a man to show up with consistency, with consciousness, with honesty. And that's when women can learn, okay, I don't have to be in control of everything. I can let go and trust.
So do you teach those four things to men?
They hear that from me all the time. And I've had countless women. I'll sit on an airplane describing this stuff to women when they ask me what I do. And women will consistently say, like, one of two things is, will you put up a website and put the guy's pictures on the website that have taken your courses or your seminars? Or can I come stand in your parking lot outside your office and wait for these guys to come out of your sessions? Women are starved for that. As I said a few minutes ago, I have empathy. You either put up with the asshole jerk that treats you like shit or the wussy doormat that bores you to tears. And there's so many strong, bright women out there. They they don't know that there's something other than those two options, because there's not been that many men that I call an integrated male that really know how to show up for prime, beginning with their own life, their own conscious, passionate, intention-filled life, and then inviting a woman to come be the icing on that great cake of a life that they're getting up every day and creating with intention.
Yeah, and you know, it's the small things, because recently I went out with someone, and when we went to dinner, he came over to where I was sitting just to help me up out of the seat, right? And then we went out again, he did the same thing. And they often say, you know, in the speaker realm, I'm a speaker. And so in that realm, they often say, people may not remember what you say, but they remember how you make them feel.
Yeah.
Speaking in a relationship, right? I may not remember every word that someone speaks to me, but I remember how I felt in a situation, how a guy made me feel. And just by coming over and, you know, taking my hand and lifting me out of the seat, it says that you're important. I'm conscious that, you know, of just being courteous and helpful, but also it makes us feel special and important in that he's actually thinking of us, as opposed to how quickly can we get out the door kind of thing. You know, and those are the things that last in a woman. Those are, you know, those feelings make us say, ooh, and draws us closer to the guy. Ooh, now I feel more connected. What else is in store? This is something he's done consistently. I like that. And just what you're talking about. And it's those kind of small things that allow us to connect on a deeper level, but also help build that trust and dependability.
And I hear that from women, and I love that men can hear it from the mouth of a woman, because again, it is exactly what I teach. And I tell guys that for women, attraction is all tied up in how a man makes them feel. And if a woman feels good while with the man, she wants more of that.
Yes.
So it means she's gonna wanna be more with that man. And guys don't get it. You know, we tend to think that women are attracted to exactly what we're attracted to. And we men tend to be attracted to body parts. So we think, well, unless we have perfect body parts, you're not going to be attracted to us. But that's not true. I remember I was dating a woman one time, and I asked her, well, okay, what is it about a man that can make a woman laugh, that can be playful and get a woman laughing? Well, what would a woman like about that? And she just says, it just makes me feel good. And she'll go, if a man can make me laugh, I don't care if he's homely, I'll do it. And I'm thinking, men need to know that women tell me all the time. You know, they tell me things like, well, I like your hands. And I never thought, well, why would my hands be a turn on to a woman? But it's these little things that make women so different than the average guy that we guys don't understand. And it is the little things that you pay attention to detail, because I tell guys, one thing I know for sure, no matter how strong or even appearing to be controlling a woman might be, Mother Nature's wired her to be a security-seeking creature. Most women don't get up every day and walk the planet thinking, oh, I feel completely safe walking down the street. You know, you never know who's going to whistle at you, who's going to catcall you, who's going to approach you, what their intention is. And women just don't feel safe in general. So that's why you have to take charge of your life to create some sense of security. And I tell guys, if you create any sense of security, and consistency is the best way to do that, open the door every time. Stand when she, you know, is getting out of her chair to go to the bathroom. My wife often wears high heels when we go out to eat, so I often escort her to the ladies' restroom, because she's walking in high heels and maybe it's a cobblestone floor in the restaurant or something. So it's the little things that make her feel like you're paying attention. Kind of going back to caveman days, that you can be the fierce provider and protector because you're paying attention to what needs to be paid attention to.
So Dr. Glover, tell us the difference between what you just described and being a nice guy, because those sound like nice guy qualities. Yeah. Like, oh, I accommodate her to the bathroom. And so what's the difference? Because I want men to be very clear on what the nice guy syndrome is and what you just described as being conscious. I think that there's going to be guys saying, well, I'm just conscious, I'm not nice guy because I don't blah, 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 whatever, when they really are the nice guy syndrome.
Right. Yeah, and guys will ask me that. They'll go, well, okay, you're opening a woman's door. How's that any different than trying to be the nice guy and get her approval? But look, I opened your door. I'm a nice guy. And it really is a difference in attitude and intention. I tell men, I have not tried to get a woman to like me since I pursued my second wife. And that was, I was in my 30s. I'm 61 now. So I've not tried to get a woman to like me in 30 years. And I've had no shortage of women showing interest in me during that time. And that's not a brag, because I've never thought of myself as the best looking guy or, you know, but what I found is that as I began to address my nice guy issues and started making my needs a priority and started having good boundaries and started telling the truth in all situations and surrounding myself with masculine energy and living with passion. And I guess maybe the best way to put it, the more I've lived my life on my terms, basically how I walk the planet is I get up every day and do what I want to do, what feels right to me. Mm-hmm. And the people who like the way I live my life are going to be attracted to me. The people who don't either aren't going to notice me at all, or they're going to have a negative reaction and get mad at me or attack me or leave. And what I found is, as I live my life on my terms, that seems to be amazingly attractive to women. And the thing that surprises most men I talk to, and it seems to be amazingly attractive to women significantly younger than me. And that's a piece I've never quite figured out, is that why I'm just living my life, not trying to get anybody, you know, to like me or pay attention to me. Women keep wanting to be around me, and it's usually women significantly younger. And I don't know if it's the confidence issue that most younger women don't see in men or what it is. But the whole opening the door thing, for example, that's my rule. And I often would tell women, no, I open your door because that's my rule. You know, and it's a playful way of saying, this is who I am. This is what you can count on. It's my rule. I set the rules for me. If you're going to hang out with me, I'm going to open your door. And I've only had one woman ever resist that. And it's too long of a story to tell, but we went out a couple times. And even though she kept resisting me opening her door, after the second date, she was turned on by me and basically wanted to take me home with her. So even though she resisted, I don't want to be controlled by anybody. I said, I'm not going to control you, but I will open the door. Mm-hmm. So I tell men, this isn't about getting a woman's approval. It's about you having a plan of how you walk the planet, and you consistently live by that plan and invite a woman to come participate in that if she wants to or not, if she doesn't want to. So it's not about getting her approval or getting her to like you. And I tell men, trying to get a woman to like you, approve of you, be available to you, want to have sex with you, trying to get a woman to do those things are all a recipe for disaster. Mm-hmm. You're not you. You're trying to become whatever you think it is she wants you to be so that she'll approve of you, want to sleep with you, go out with whatever it is. And that does not turn women on or make them feel safe. So it still goes back to men learning to live life on their terms. I call it being a differentiated self, where you ask yourself, what do I want? What's important to me? And then you live on those terms. And if people that like hanging out with you, great. They don't, great. But don't try to get somebody to approve of you. And that's the big difference.
Yeah. And the thing is when you try and get someone to approve of you, what ends up happening is then you've got to continue to play that role that's not really you
forever.
That's just going to eat you up inside and make you miserable and resentful and basically living in pain and hurt. And so you've got to either play that role, or then you've got to decide, okay, well, I'm going to not play that role anymore, and I'm going to go way over here to who I am. And then the woman's going to be like, well, who is that? I have no idea who that is, because you've been this person forever. And kind of on that note, so what happens when a man and a woman is in a relationship, man's been Mr. Nice Guy, and he decides that he doesn't want to be Mr. Nice Guy, excuse me, anymore. He decides, I'm going to take back my power. I'm going to take control. I'm going to start being who I really am. What happens with him? But what also happened? How does the dynamic of the relationship change?
Okay. And that's a good question. I actually address that in my book, No More Mr. Nice Guy. Here's what I've found over time. I say in the book that when I first started looking at the dynamic of nice guy syndrome, especially for men in relationships, I came to see that if the guy started working on his nice guy issues while in a long-term relationship, he had about a 50-50 chance of the relationship surviving. Now, I write in the book that the longer I worked with that, I started looking at it as more like 60-40 of it not working. And then it got to be about 70-30. I'm at about 80-20 now. If you start working on your nice guy issues, you start telling the whole truth. That's going to shake the shit out of the relationship. It's going to mix it up good, all right? Telling the whole truth, not holding anything back. Making your needs a priority. Asking for what you want. Setting boundaries. Spending time with men. Living your passion. If you start doing those things, it will blow up the relationship. Now, the good news is, if you guys have some help and can deal with that, and you get through it, you're going to have a hell of a relationship with a hell of a partner. And if not, you found out, okay, you're not a good match. It was time to move on from each other. Now, here's the deal. Even though it may scare some women, and I know because they send me emails and I have a forum where they can go to, it may scare some women when their nice guy partner reads my book and starts making some changes. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes the changes the guy makes, I call it kind of like kamikaze boundary setting. As he learns to start setting boundaries when he used to have none, he'll use a chainsaw when maybe a fly swatter would have done. And the women start going, wait a minute, what's going on here? I don't know if I can deal with this. But the irony is, countless men tell me they found my book or found me because their wife, an ex-girlfriend, an ex-wife, a woman therapist gave them the book. Mm. So the irony is that women in general really like what I'm teaching men about showing up consciousness and honesty. I mean, that's why I'm on your show. So even though it may scare a woman that doesn't want to make changes if she's in a relationship, maybe the dysfunction is comfortable to her, mm-hmm. and it can be scary, they also have a chance of really taking the relationship to the next level. And that's when it becomes what I call a relationship becomes a powerful personal growth machine, where both of them will say, okay, I'm in, let's see where it's taking us. Both people are going to grow significantly.
Join us next week when we continue this conversation in next week's episode.